Welcome to LankanTutor episode 2.02 in biology, and today what we're learning is water, the physical and chemical properties of it. We all know what water is. It's a liquid form of hydrogen and oxygen, which we use in our day-to-day life, be it drinking or washing yourself or anything. Everything needs water. In fact, we're 70% water. But that's not going to cut it. We're going to have to go into the details of how water works and what exactly water is and its properties. So without further ado, let's begin. Water is the most abundant organic molecule on the planet. It consists of 65 to 90% of most plants and animals, and the human body is around 60 to 70% water. 70% of the Earth's surface is also covered with water. And we also believe that life originated in water, the quaternary molecule or the biological bog that started 3.5 billion years ago was also on water. So how exactly is water formed? Water is the covalent bonding of two hydrogen atoms with one oxygen atom. If you don't know what a covalent bond and ionic bonds are, don't worry, we're going to cover that in chemistry. The oxygen atom is shared by the two hydrogen atoms. The oxygen atom gives a force and it pulls on the orbitals of the hydrogen atom because oxygen has a higher electronegativity. We don't really need to know that in detail, but just get a general idea of it. So oxygen is slightly negative and hydrogen is slightly positive. Because of that, this molecule becomes a polar molecule. Now, the thing about molecules and polarity is it's very deep. You don't need to go so far in biology, but you will learn those in chemistry. Polar molecules react with polar molecules and nonpolar molecules react with nonpolar molecules. Just remember that. Well, not generally react, but you could say dissolve. Like dissolves like. So polar dissolves polar, nonpolar dissolves nonpolar. Just remember that, it will help you out in the long run. Water is a triangular molecule, and the angles between the molecule is exactly 104.5 degrees. Yes, I know you guys don't like memorizing numbers, but again, you are not given a choice here. Water comprises of a specific type of bonds called hydrogen bonds. Because of this, it gets a lot of unique properties. So we're going to go into those properties and we're going to discuss them one by one. At the end of this unit, you should be able to recite all of them without getting any wrong. And if they ask an essay question about describe the physical properties of water or describe the chemical or the physical and chemical properties of water, you should be able to list out all of them without dropping a single point in order for you to get marks. Something we all know is that water is a liquid at room temperature. That's actually a point, so remember that. The reason that water is a liquid at room temperature is because of the hydrogen bonds. What is room temperature? Room temperature is generally considered as 25 degrees Celsius. They take it as a specific place. I believe it is a specific place in the United Kingdom, just like we take Greenwich as the standard time. Water is an excellent solvent. Part of the reason is that it's a polar molecule, and polar molecules can react with other polar molecules and dissolve. And the other thing is, because of the hydrogen bonding, water has the ability to dissolve with nonpolar molecules as well. Remember, it's not all nonpolar molecules, but some of them, which makes water an excellent solvent for various reactions. Almost all the reactions that take place in the human body happen because of water. Well, there is also another property of water which is really cool. It's called cohesion. Now, cohesion is the ability for a water molecule to attract itself to another water molecule. The best example for you to see cohesion is when you have drops of water on top of a leaf. You can see that the drops of water get together and form this round ball. It tries to get itself together and it forms one singular unit. That is because of this property called cohesion. If water didn't have cohesion, it would not form balls of water, and it would be an equally spread out even layer. Just like cohesion, there's another property called adhesion. Adhesion is the ability for water to react or to attract different molecules, which doesn't necessarily have to be water. Now, if you take a cup, or preferably a test tube, and fill it up with water, you'll see that the line of water isn't straight. That near the edges, it lifts a little bit up. That is an example of adhesion, where the water molecules attract to a different substance, in which this case it would be glass. The best way to give an example for adhesion and cohesion working together is called the capillary forces. Water travels through tubes like capillary tubes. It happens because of the adhesion and cohesion forces. The cohesion forces keeps the water molecules together, while the adhesion forces keeps on attracting itself to the edges of the capillary tube, and it drives the entire column of water upwards. That's the best example you can give for adhesion and cohesion. Now, in biology, in transportation of water, there's this whole thing called the adhesion-cohesion tension theory, and it'll explain how the potentials of water differ and how it's actually physically transported up plants, which will give you bigger detail about adhesion and cohesion. But for now, just remember that adhesion is the ability for water molecules to react. Sorry, I keep on saying react. It's the ability for water molecules to attract to different substances, and cohesion is the ability for water molecules to attract to other water molecules. Because of the cohesive forces in water, there's another property which relates to that. It's called surface tension. When there's a lot of water in one place and the surface of it, instead of being separate molecules, it forms one thin film or one thin layer above it. If you've noticed animals like water skates and mosquitoes and how they can land on water and their feet, they can actually sit on it because of their light weight. The force they exert on the film of water above it is so minute it doesn't send the animal or whatever the substance that lands on water sinking in. Now that's because of this property called surface tension. The surface of the water layer exerts a force and keeps a thin film holding it in one place. Another property of water is high specific heat capacity. Now, what exactly is specific heat capacity? It is the amount of energy needed to increase the heat of 1 kilogram of substance, in which this case would be water, by 1 Celsius or 1 Kelvin. Now, because of having a high specific heat capacity, it lets organisms contain large internal reservoirs of water and manage the internal temperature. And it also helps keep the chemical reactions in the cell at the optimum temperature. Now, if water wasn't resistant to change, the entire functioning of our body would stop, as a little bit more of heat would increase the temperature of the body and destroy proteins and even untangle the DNA strands. Water having a high specific heat capacity stops this from happening. The next property is called having high latent heat of vaporization. Now remember, in all the parts where I said having high latent heat of vaporization or having high specific heat capacity, if you do not mention the word high, you won't be getting marks, because it's not that it has a specific heat capacity or it has a latent heat of vaporization, because everything has that. It's just that it has a high, you have to make that point very specific. It has a high specific heat capacity and it has a high latent heat of vaporization. Now, what exactly is latent heat of vaporization? It is the amount of heat necessary to evaporate water. So it's basically to change the state from liquid to gas. Because of this, it draws materials underneath the surfaces, creating a cooling effect. For example, take the transpiration in plants. It provides a great cooling effect for the plant, and also sweat evaporating from your skin, that happens because of latent heat of vaporization. Again, this all helps to maintain the internal temperature of the body. And then again, water has a high latent heat of fusion. When you guys know that water is a liquid at room temperature, and water below 0 degrees Celsius, and when it goes below 0 degrees Celsius, it becomes ice. After it becomes water at 0 degrees Celsius, it has to lose a lot more heat to turn into ice. Again, just like it turning into gas from liquid, turning into solid from liquid requires a lot of energy. And when water freezes, the density decreases as a result of this. And as a result of this, ice floats on water instead of sinking. The next part we have is the animalous expansion of water. What this is, let me teach you by example. If you have a large pond or reservoir that heat freezes up during the winter, imagine what would happen if ice starts to form from the bottom up. All the organisms, all aquatic life would cease to exist. Because of animalous expansion of water, lakes and reservoirs and any body of water will freeze from the top down instead of bottom up. And we go to the final part of, or the final property of water, which happens to be transparency. The reason why the transparency helps water is because it allows light to travel through water. Now, if you may know, photosynthesis requires light. And most of the oxygen that is generated in the atmosphere, or actually on this planet, is from underwater seaweed and other algae. So if light does not travel through water, that means that the plants and all aquatic organisms that require light to produce basically oxygen and continue photosynthesis can't really do that. Since water is transparent, that isn't a problem, and that is how we get most of our oxygen. So there we have it. We have covered all the important parts of water, the properties to be exact. It is a liquid at room temperature. It has a high polarity, hence it is a great solvent. It has great chemical properties. It is a reactant in some biochemical processes like photosynthesis, hydrolysis. It has high adhesive forces and it has high cohesive forces. It has high surface tension. It has a high specific heat capacity, high latent heat of vaporization, a high latent heat of fusion, animalous expansion, and it also has transparency. The final things to know are the four major functions of water, which really isn't a big deal, but they tend to ask to name out the four main functions of water, so might as well learn this as well, so you don't have to regret later. The first one is it is a component of protoplasm. It means the majority of the cell comprises of water. It is a great solvent. That's number two. Number three, it is a great reactant. And finally, it helps in maintaining turgidity. Turgidity is, for example, take herbaceous plants like, let's take a banana tree. If you've seen them, you know that the stem isn't necessarily wood. So how do they stay upright? It's really hard for herbaceous plants, which means green plants without a woody stem, to stay upright. Because of the columns of water that travel through these plants, that's how they stay straight. And those are the four main functions of water in organisms. Now remember that those, the four main functions of water in living organisms. Thank you guys for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you want tutorials, visit us at LankanTutor.com. We will also get you guys some notes which will help you. Possibly you can print it out and give it to your friends. It's completely fine as long as you do not resell them. Again, thank you guys for watching this video. And Remember to like, comment, and subscribe if you do enjoy this video. If you're not watching this on LankanTutor.com, please do so. And as always, have a great day. We'll see you on the next episode. And if this video did help you out in some way, please don't forget to share it to one of your friends.